My name is Joseph Fourchon, and I'm the Chief Technology Officer at Modco Offshore.
My name is Chris Moran. I'm the owner and operator of Moran's Marina and also the event site of Port Fourchon Marina.
I'm Ben Bordelon. I work at Bollinger Shipyards, and I'm CEO and President.
Matt, Sea Support Ventures, HSC Coordinator.
Randy Adams, President, Sea Support Ventures.
Eddie Colley, I work for Vision Communications, and I hold a position of Enterprise Service Delivery Manager for Vision.
So the FOA started years ago. We finally got everything moving in 2010, which was right around the BP oil spill. And they had a couple of local businessmen that got together and talked about the idea of forming the Fourchon Oilmans. And really, the BP oil spill delayed that process by a year. We felt that during that time period wouldn't be the best time to start a new tournament with. It's hard to have a fishing tournament when you can't go fishing. So we delayed it 1 year. And after that, we really started our efforts into growing the Fourchon Oilman tournament to what it is today.
I joined the Fourchon Oilman's board in 2014. So this is my first year on the board. This past rodeo, Vision participated with a team in the rodeo. So that's really how I've become involved with the FOA.
You know, me, my involvement, no matter what my position in the organization, I will always be involved in grounds and things like that because it's hosted at my facility.
You have to have fresh ideas, you know, and it's nice for us this year taking a step back and watching it in a different light from what we're usually watching it in. And, you know, it's we're bringing it up to the next level, and it takes fresh ideas. You know, we still heavily involved. We still, you know, communicate with this almost on a daily basis, but it's always nice to bring new ideas to bring it up to the next level.
As a board member of the Fourchon Oilmans, you have many different duties, and this is not our day job running a tournament. So everybody has to contribute time and donate their efforts and resources into helping support make this a successful tournament. And at the meetings that we have monthly, it depends on what time of year what we're going to be talking about. So if you talk about meetings right after a tournament, obviously we talk about lessons learned, things that we can improve on.
We generally then switch gears to for the granting process. So making sure that the applications are coming in and looking at the applications, having meetings right before the December meeting to verify how much money, all the bills have been paid for the last fishing tournament, how much money do we actually have left to be able to give back to the community in grants, and then verifying that the grants are, you know, that, like I said, that they're going to the appropriate organizations and for things that meet our charter. Pretty much in January, we start with the registration process for the for that year's fishing tournament. And January all the way through June up until the July date of the fishing tournament is all plan and prep.
We discuss from the drinks to the hors d'oeuvres to the main course, to a chef station, trawl broad arches, where we're going to position everything. You know, every meeting we probably take one part of the event and discuss it thoroughly and go to the next, also with new business of we're gonna, you know, what are we gonna do next, what are we gonna do different, what worked, what didn't work, where are we gonna improve, where are we gonna bring the wow factor to it.
Yeah, it's kind of like the NFL. There's no off season. You need to start right away. We always feel that, you know, how can we better it each year? And I really believe we've set a high standard with the quality that we're producing here at the Fourchon Oilmans. And each year, in order to maintain that and that growth, you have to stay focused on it. So what we do is, Randy Adams was our first chairman, which was great. He set a great tone. Now we have Joe Ogeron, who's doing a great job. And from the leadership that the chairman provide, we kind of task out different areas to different folks, and they take the responsibility. So you may have a grounds coordinator, that's going to handle that. You may have the catering people that are going to handle that, entertainment, all of those different things. Sponsorship, Ms. Karen Dewey does a fantastic job of leading that for us. So throughout the whole year, everybody owns a piece of what makes the Fourchon tick. And from there, they have support that people fall under them on.
So, again, the Fishing Rodeo is our only event that the FOA puts on. Quite a few things make it very unique. So one, it's an invitational event only. So applicants have to go on the website and actually fill out an application with an opportunity to participate.
We limit to 100 teams, and the entry fee is, you know, not cheap at $5,000 per 10-person team. But that's what needs to be, that, you know, that's the amount it needs to be in order to be able to raise the amount of money to put on an event like that and then have enough to be able to give $100,000+ back to the community after the end of it.
We're taking on more corporate sponsors where they donate money to come in. Everybody want to get under the tent because it's tents 180
by 80, I think.
You know, year. And it's all air conditioned, all plushed out, and you know, flooring and everything else. It meets with the some of the upper fishing tournaments, like in the Bahamas, you go and things like that. And you know, I've had quite a few people that said I've went to a lot of fishing tournaments and we don't see many like this.
The FOA, the Fourchon Oilman Rodeo, is in a class by itself as far as fishing rodeos here. You know, you're in an air conditioned tent. If catered food, hors d'oeuvres. We have great people that, you know, not only are the participants great organizations that participate, but we also have, you know, those that we invite, special invites that come and each night, and, you know, and the music, I mean, we don't have a big band blowing it out. We have a one-man band playing good music the whole time. Everybody can talk and interact. It's, you know, why the biggest thing for me as a marina owner, I wanted it to be a family, you know. One thing that grows in any environment is the family, if you have the family element involved in it. Fourchon Oilman has that. That's the one rodeo that, you know, the wives dress up and come to the event with their husbands. You know, it's just really nice.
You know, when you sell 100 teams with 10 on a per team, and you got 1,000 people under a tent, that's a lot of folks. And what we don't want to do is have an overcrowding where it's uncomfortable for people. And we want it in an environment that works well for a fishing tournament, but also where you can do business and have conversation and keep it at a very high level.
Historically given nice Yeti ice chests, always great Shimano fishing reels, pretty much to almost every place. This year, I was able to get a really good price on some titanium pliers, fishing pliers, super lightweight, non-rusting, that were enjoyable. GoPros, cameras, Costa Del Mar sunglasses, polarized sunglasses is a big gift or door prize item that we like to give. Four-wheelers, of course, a boat. We've given contender boats, express boats, fishing boats.
We don't know what our wow factor is going to be for next year yet. You know, last year, you know, like I said, we made some cutbacks on some of the awards where just a handful, a third or whatever, was getting prizes where everyone could get a good prize. You know, and I think we're gonna. There's gonna be something. I don't know. It's gonna be a surprise.
Actually, every participant on a team entry, both the guests on the team and their anglers, each got a K2 cooler with logo, with the Fourchon Oilman logo on it.
The company that we use through Rusty and Joe and these guys came up with a big LED screen that showed footage of everything else. So it was gonna throw you back. And, you know, they brought it into a new technology where we have all, you know, big TV screens all around the tent where people could see the donors, the prizes, the where you stand on the board. And we even had a UNO came in, their computer science department, and wrote up a program for the fishing tournament where if you're offshore and you have internet access, you can look your team online, see what fish you know, what's on the board, what's not, and you get a notice if you on the board and get knocked off. And in the last year or so, there's a lot of technology going into it that's bringing it way up there.
Sean, that side right there helps on the wildlife and fisheries, with, you know, which has come in and helped us out, because if you catch a fish that you think, you know, is not large enough, you can release him back into the water. You don't have to necessarily keep him, you know. I mean, especially on the larger species, you know, they don't have to bring them all the way in and then find out that they don't even make the fishing board, you know, the leaderboard.
We've already started thinking about the big gift, you know, that we're going to do with some possibilities, because we like changing it up. We like impressing, you know, whenever visitors come and they get the prizes and the event, the, you know, the air conditioned tent, the nice gourmet food. Just today somebody told me, you know, it's the first fishing rodeo I go to that has tablecloths, you know. And I've had wives come to me and say, you know, I've been to fishing rodeos, I don't want to go with my husband to fishing rodeo, except for this one. This is a rodeo I don't mind going to. So we're trying to, you know, keep that ambiance. And of course, like I said, the networking of the industry people is very important. And whenever a corporation can make a worthwhile donation and be able to entertain clients and network all at the same time and know that their contribution is going back to the community that they're serving, I think it's a win-win all the way around.
I think the best gift we give, though, I mean, we give ice chests and fishing rods and those type of things, as well as boats and other stuff, but the biggest gifts we give is the grants that we give out in the community. There's no question on that, and the scholarships we do, and that's really what it's all about. And you know, the prizes are nice and whatnot, but at the end of the day, when you're giving out over $100,000 every year to charities and schools and really impacting students in the area, that's really the gift and the reason why this started. You know, the fishing type gifts and whatnot, that's really just the carrot that helps bring the people to the event. And you know, combined with that, with the high quality product of the tent layout and setup, and as well as the participants having a captured audience, all adds value to the end result of helping the community. So there's two separate deals. We have the scholarships that we give out to family of participating members. So if you work at a company that's a participating member of the Fourchon Oilman, then any of your kids, for that matter, are eligible to receive the scholarship.
For the scholarships, we usually get about 7 to 10 scholarships. And We provide them to the board members and do a vote on from their essays on which one's the most responsive to oil and gas industry and can make best use of the scholarship money. And that's done in May, or you know, April and May timeframe.
Typically what we try to do is 3 scholarships a year. 2 scholarships on traditional schooling, if you will, 4-year degree, 2-year degree, and 1 technical college scholarship.
My honor to provide 2 $4,000 scholarships. We do it as $500 per semester for 4 years, where you have to maintain a 2.5 GPA and stay full-time. And the 2 recipients, seniors this year, are Nicholas Bruce and Jake Williams.
My name is Nicholas Bruce, and I'm from Cut Off, Louisiana. I attended South Lafourche High School, and I graduated in 2014. I'm pursuing a bachelor's in petroleum services and an associate's in safety. It's kind of like a 1-degree thing. I'm pretty much open to any job I get, because during the summer, I have a job with my uncle David. He runs a small boat company. And they said, since the safety part, he said, I always have a job if I'm ready for it, like to do the safety part. Thank you a lot with my heart, because that really helped me pay a lot for my college expenses and my living expenses and all that. $500 a semester, that helps a lot. So I just want to really say thank you very much.
The grant side, it's a process where Anybody in the area can submit an application. You need to have a description of what your need is, obviously. And what we do, we have a committee that goes through it, and then there's a final board approval. But we try to disperse the funds as much as we can to touch as many of the applicants that we can, pending on the projects. And we do take them serious. It's something that we read every single application. We'll question the folks that are submitting it to make sure that it's a valid project that they're going to do, and it's something that, that's really going to make impact in the community. So we've given from churches to schools to nonprofit organizations up and down the bayou, and it's really been well. And I think the feedback we've received and the support we received for the Fourchon Oilmans due to this has been great.
There's a small little Baptist church in Valentine that they came last year, I think it was, and they wanted like 11. They came with a finite number, which is unusual in stuff like that, because usually they'll ask for 1,000 or 5,000. But they came with a number like $987.13 or something like that, you know. And so we asked them what it was for, and all they wanted to do was add a room to the side of the church so that they could have their little meetings after church and have a place to cut cake, drink coffee, whatever, and everything. So we ended up, I think we gave them 1,500 or maybe 2,000 or something like that.
The main criteria that we look for is that the monies that we give actually go back to the local community and not a local organization that plans on spending it elsewhere or out of the community. We really want the money to be put back into the community in one way, shape, or form. So needs, I mean, primarily the ones that we've gotten grants from, that we've given the actual monies to at our December meeting has been local schools, both public and private and parochial schools, as well as senior citizens, Restore and Retreat, La Reflection de Bayou, so a lot of the community organizations here, as well as some at Community Life Center, counseling centers, and things like that.
That for me, giving this grant, Ed Mott was the first one I looked at, and I could just see it in his eyes, and he could see it in mine, and we were both just like, wow.
We've had a lot of schools have participated and filled out grants, and we've been able to award money both to both some of the Catholic schools, private schools, as well as public schools. And last year's round of funding seemed to be a lot of Promethean boards, as well as iPad labs were a big topic. We've done other things, bricks and mortar projects, if you will, such as the Boy Scouts building at the LaRose Civic Center. We were able to donate some money there to help restore that building.
Our first presentation of grants, to where you've seen, you know, the look on people's faces when they have their grants and what they could do with it, and I think that's probably the best, you know, just doing these presentations where you give them the check and they know what they want to, it answers their prayer to them.
My name is Greta Gidra and I'm the media specialist at Golden Meadow Middle School.
Hi, my name is Tara Dedivo and I am the executive director at Hope Extreme.
I am Simone Malaz and I'm the executive director of Restore or Retreat.
Hope Extreme was started in 2007. We had done some things before then in the community. We helped people. We did some feeding programs, went out into the streets in East Houma and just played with kids and things like that. But we actually became an official nonprofit in 2007. We just saw the need was more than just food, more than just a program. It was going to be an all-encompassing. So in 2007, we became a nonprofit. In 2008, we bought the building here. We are located right in the middle of East Houma, and our goal is to bring radical change to the lives of East Houma's urban youth. And we're doing that educationally, spiritually, and in the community. Our two signature programs are our after-school program, which runs Monday through Wednesday. 70 kids are here for 2 hours every day. They get homework help labs, reading labs, math labs, and an elective course. In the summer is our second signature program. It's our summer program, and it focuses on reading. mostly comprehension and fluency, which helps the kids be prepared for their next school year. We also have Hope Gardens, which is a gardening project that the kids do in their electives, and we sell the produce from there. We do something called Hope Serves, where we go out once a month and serve the community, teenagers and people. We go back into East Houma and serve. And we also have Hope Teens, which helps teenagers get ready for life after school, getting them towards college and into the job. And East Houma is known for poverty, at-risk kids, as well as whenever you think of that side of town, I think it has a little bit of a demeaning a name to it. And so we just wanted to come and bring hope to areas that traditionally have been seen as hopeless.
Our school is comprised of 6th, 7th, and 8th graders. We have approximately 326 students whose ages range from 11 to 15 years old.
Basically almost a similar group that formed the LA One Coalition started this for a restoration component. And we deal mostly with restoration. Of course, we have to know what's going on in protection with levees and things like that, but we deal solely with restoration. And so Charlotte Bollinger, Alex Plaisance, Robert Nakan, there's a couple of core group of people that helped formed our organization. And like I said, you know, some are still with us too. Ted Falgu's on our executive committee. It was Roy Francis at first, and then Henri Boulay. So we have some very familiar faces to the community that lead us in our decision making every day. And then, like I said, we have this bigger board of directors that is government people and business owners and a diverse group of people that have said they cared about, you know, making sure that we have some success here in South Louisiana.
I help students locate information. I teach them how to conduct research using books and the internet. I teach them how to use the internet wisely, how to evaluate websites that they're using to ensure that the information is valid and reliable. And I also teach them how to properly cite the sources that they are using in their research.
As executive director, I do everything. we're raising money for our new building project, so I've taken that on. We're currently moving to a location on Grand Cayou that's going to triple our growth, as far as we're going to allow more kids in the program, but we're also going to have parking available and stuff like that. So a big part of my task, it seems right now, is raising funding for that so that we can move in. But also I personally run the homework help stations here at tutoring, and then we do a lot of promotions and speaking. I speak and just really sort of take care of all of the loose ends all around the organization.
A Promethean board is basically a large interactive display. They help to keep the students engaged in your lessons. The students are eager. They want to get up there. They want to be able to touch it. They're really excited about being able to use their fingers to write.
Every kid is dropped off the bus from their schools here at the program, and then afterwards we bring most every child home because of the level of poverty or just lack of transportation. So we do run that on our summer program, our teen service, our church, everything. We have four vans that we're constantly using to get people in and out of our center.
One of the things that we do that in our grant requests have been for every year is we want to expand field trips. A lot of times what we do is very hard for people to see. What does that mean, you know, that you're creating marsh or that you're building a beach? And so it's very important for us to take people to see, you know, what's going on and what this project means. So we've done quite a few field trips. We've become quite good at them. We go to different areas. A lot of times we'll go to, marsh areas. We've been out to the Maritime Forest Ridge in Port Fourchon. We've been out to Caminata so many times. We go out in marshes in Central Terrebonne. So we want people to see. It's really hard for people to sometimes wrap their head around what does this project mean. So a lot of times we go out before a project, we'll go out during a project, and then we want them to see them after a project. But most of the time that involves boats, it involves four-wheel drive equipment, you know, there's like some logistical things to that. So other grant requests have included, we funded a scholarship here at Nichols for students interested in coastal restoration. So it mostly has to do with education and outreach. And this past year, we were very proud to receive our grant and half of it had to do with technology. Because not everybody can come with us, we wanted to kind of take the field trip to them. So we wanted to get like a GoPro camera. A lot of times we're in the field and we have to roll out these maps and, I mean, you know, all these materials. But if we had something like an iPad or something, we could Google Earth something and show somebody in a boat right there where we are without having to do some of those things. So we were very excited that this year our grant had a technology component to that, because we think that if you can't come with us, we want to bring it to you. And so I think that's going to help us in our outreach efforts.
But fortunate to receive the grant, I felt that I was excited that we were a grant recipient because I knew that we needed some technology upgrades here in the library. I had an old smart board, and this is much more interactive.
We're excited. We're excited just to partner with people in the community. We are a community organization, and we're grassroots. We're not the big brother and sister or those kind of things, and so we need desperately help from people in the community that believe that HOMA can be a better place, that this area can be a better place. And so we love when people that are local partner with us, because it touches our heart and know, hey, your work's not unnoticed. And for us, it's so hard to get those big grants or those big associations where it's a federal loan or those kind of things. And so for us, when we get someone that comes behind us in the community, the community gets better. And so that's our goal.
I think what FOA is doing is really, so they have this fantastic foundation where they have a very successful tournament, and I'm sure, you know, they have a great time, and it means, you know, it's fun for people then. But what that foundation does is it kind of builds this legacy in the community, right? I mean, I understood all the people, you know, I was there when they gave out the donations, and the amount of people that they help and the diversity of that, and that it's so important that they have this foundation, and they really are building a legacy in the community. They're helping people that otherwise, you know, might have trouble.
We just want to say thank you to the organization. We couldn't do it. We could not do these things without you. We could not do, every kid that walks through the door is because people believe in what we do. And when you see a kid smiling, or when you see a kid who just this past month told us, "I'm dumb," because she speaks Spanish as her first language, and then comes in and makes a C for the first time in her life, that's because of you. And that's because of what you've given to help us continue to do that. So we thank you. We just can't do these things without people believing in what we're a part of.
I want them to really know, again, and I use it a lot, but that the foundation that they're building and that they have thought it out and that they've been so successful, that is something, that's the legacy they're going to leave in the community, you know, they might never build a building, you know, called FOA or anything like that, but know that everything that they're doing is going to last, not just that year, you know, it's going to last into the future.
Thank you for supporting our community by selecting us as a recipient for this grant. Thank you for contributing to the education of our students to help prepare them for college and for the workforce.
It truly made me a better person, because like I wasn't involved in church. I would be like hanging out with streets and doing crazy things, and you know, I found out Miss Tara came to, when I was at Oakland, she came to a club that we had, and it's just been different ever since, man. I plan on going to college. I want to become a principal. I just love helping the other people. I just love serving other people.
So So from the growth standpoint and the change in the Fourchon almonds, there's some things that we've talked about initially is some of the layouts. One thing we try to monitor is the flow of people inside the tent. Where are people congregating? Bathroom flows and all of those different things are important. Quality of food, we definitely talk about that each night. It's not like we wait until the next week. Actually, there's a group of us that we'll go around and check all our quality of food. It's easy to test and eat good Cajun food, as you know. But it's important for us to keep that the highest level of quality on all of the areas of it.
We continue to try to raise the bar. I know it's a tall order, but each year we try to critique what didn't go so well or how can we improve, even though, you know, maybe it wasn't that it didn't go so well, but we keep focusing on how we can improve the event.
We also are looking at partnering with other local charitable organizations on the bayou to try to leverage the amount of money we give out back to the community to find there are other foundations that do matching funds, that if you give back to the community, they'll match funds and also give them give back in other ways.
We halfway done already for next year. We it started the week after. The longer you go through it, like we're on our fourth year now, going to our fourth year, it's getting easier and easier. The first year and the second year was very difficult, you know, of organizing everything. And now we have lists and, you know, we got stuff. This is what we have to do. This is the date we have to accomplish it by and things like that. So it's getting easier.
I think, if you will, we have started to get our feet under us, if you will, getting a very good handle and throwing the rodeo. I know one of the things as a board that we're going to focus on is actually creating a sponsorship committee that's going to be focused on the entire year of soliciting sponsorships for this event.
I see it growing and growing. I see, you know, we've always wanted to maintain 100 groups, 100 team maximum, but at some point, and the purpose and point and purpose of that was to always be able to hold on to that quality, you know, and that exclusivity and keep it really nice. But I think at some point, possibly we'll have to go up a little bit on the numbers just to be able to accommodate everybody that wants to participate.
I think the exciting thing for me was being a founding member of it. You know, us collectively having the vision, the foresight into doing this, and then the follow through. You know, it's one thing to talk about coming up with something, and it's another thing to follow through with it and see it really take root and expand itself. And I think from where we are in those early discussions back during the 2010 days and to here we are now in 2015 and where this tournament has evolved to. And really the challenge for us as founding members is to make something that's gonna last.
The event is something where you meet people that you hadn't seen all year and, you know, it's a friendly competition, but it's, you know, we're almost all in the same business, but we're not competitors there. We're just friends gathering for a good cause and, you know, having fun and enjoying the stories and what we've done last year and how much we've grown and what we've given and the guys coming up and saying, you know, y'all did a good thing here. We really appreciate it and I see where our donation is going to and I like it.
I've met some people that I kind of just kind of knew like that, you know, but I've grown to know them.
You know, the weigh-ins, if I had to say there's one thing, if you ever come and watch the weigh-ins, everybody, you got 150, 200 people standing around, boats coming in, beautiful boats coming in with their catch. Everybody's happy. Everybody's really at that peak of sharing their camaraderie, you know, that fishing camaraderie. And it's a good, fun, it's fun sport.
Meeting all the people that are in my industry, who I meet, you know, on a social basis at different events, but this is one that really brings them all together in the oil and gas production industry and service industry. And, you know, and knowing that we're doing something that we're able to give back to the community really makes it fulfilling.
How well everything's flowed so smoothly. And that's just a testament to the planning and what the board has learned over the first 3 to 4 years. And with the commitment of the board members involved, as well as all of the sponsors who are involved and help bring this event together, that's probably my most memorable memory, if you will, that I was so impressed at how everything flowed.
I'd like everybody to really know that what the impact that the Fourchon Oilman's event makes on the community. I'd like everybody in the community and in the oil and gas industry, even if you can't participate, you know, there's levels of sponsorship, I mean, that you can participate, and it goes to great causes.
Well, the FOA is a group of guys that got together to do some good into the community. You know, it's people that, you know, have generous hearts, willing to donate more time than money, actually. You know, it's a big time consuming thing, and the rewards are good on it. You know, we're here to help the community. We've been a little under the radar, and we've grown so much in the last 3 years that it, you know, I never would have expected this to grow this fast. You know, I thought it was a work in progress, and you know, we're here and we're gonna be here for a long time.
I think, you know, you hear FOA in the community and so many people think it's this high-end fishing rodeo only. Again, from our first experience in 2013, it's a great, just the value it brings in terms of a business social event is remarkable.
That we're primarily people from the bayou, you know, that and we want to give back to the bayou. We've, you know, local businessmen who make their living and their, you know, wealth creation and jobs, you know, living in this community, working locally in this community within the energy industry, and, you know, doing our best to, you know, to tap in to the vast wealth of the energy companies to be able to give back and put back into the local community. And that the people that are running this, the Fourchon Oilman's Association, are generally people that live and work here as well.
We've really set a high standard of what we expect of this tournament, and you can really bring anybody to this tournament as it relates to wives or girlfriends or stuff like that. It's a really high caliber tournament that its focus is to obviously support the oil and gas industry here in the Gulf of Mexico. But more importantly, support the local community that in fact supports the oil and gas industry. So we care about all of the surrounding areas, from the churches to the schools to the grocery stores to all of the things that support and make this oil and gas industry great right here in Lafourche Parish.
The next award is the Community Hero Award. This is presented to the Fourchon Oilman's Association. Since its inception in 2009, the FOA has contributed 12 scholarships totaling over $40,000 and 79 grants, totaling, listen to this, ladies and gentlemen, $350,000. I would just like to say on behalf of the Board of Directors, thanks to the community. As was mentioned earlier, it is the people in the community that were willing to step up and create this organization. And I think we accomplished what we were trying to do, is promote the oil and gas industry by hosting a nice event that people can attend, and also donating to education and charitable organizations in our community. So again, thanks to the Chamber, and thank you all for attending.
They paved paradise and put up a parking lot with a pink hotel, a boutique, and a swinging hot spot. Don't it always seem to go that you don't know what you got till it's gone? They paved paradise and put up a parking lot. They took all the trees and put them in a tree museum, and they charge the people a dollar and a half to see them. No, 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 don't it always seem to go that you don't know what you got till it's gone? You pay a paradise and put up a fucking lie. Ooh, bop, bop, bop. Ooh, bop, bop, bop. Hey, fun.
paradise to put up a fucking lie. And now they pay paradise to put up a fucking lie.